And we are beginning a new series this quarter, or these few months, 2 months, consolidating the harvest. We've gone through quite a number of teachings in various sectors, and today we begin with the sector on education, and we shall hear about 10 times better what we have learned and how we plan to proceed from the education team. And in preparation, I'd like to read a scripture from Daniel chapter 1, from verse 1 to 20. Daniel 1, verse 1 to 20. During the third year of King Jehoiakim's reign in Judah, King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon came to Jerusalem and besieged it. The Lord gave him victory over King Jehoiakim of Judah and permitted him to take some of the sacred objects from the temple of God. So Nebuchadnezzar took them back to the land of Babylonia and placed them in the treasure house of his God. Then the king ordered Ashpenaz, his chief of staff, to bring to the palace some of the young men of Judah's royal family and other noble families who had been brought to Babylon as captives. "Select only strong, healthy, and good-looking young men," he said. I don't know why they're good-looking. "Make sure they are well-versed in every branch of learning, are gifted, and are with knowledge and good judgment, and are suited to serve in the royal palace." Maybe that is what our young ladies should be looking for in their search. "Train these young men in the language and literature of Babylon. The king assigned them a daily ration of food and wine from his own kitchens. They were to be trained for 3 years, and then they'd enter the royal service." Verse 6. "Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah were four of the young men chosen, all from the tribe of Judah. The chief of staff renamed them with these Babylonian names. Daniel was called Belteshazzar, Hananiah was called Shadrach, Mishael was called Meshach, Azariah was called Abednego. But Daniel was determined not to defile himself by eating the food and wine given to them by the king. He asked the chief of staff for permission not to eat these unacceptable foods. Now God had given the chief of staff both respect and affection for Daniel. But he responded, 'I'm afraid of my lord the king, who has ordered that you eat this food and wine. If you become pale and thin compared to the other youths your age, I'm afraid the king will have me beheaded.' Daniel spoke with the attendant who had been appointed by the chief of staff to look after Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. 'Please test us for 10 days on a diet of vegetables and water.' Daniel said, 'At the end of the 10 days, see how we look compared to the other young men who are eating the king's food. Then make your decision in light of what you see.' The attendant agreed to Daniel's suggestion and tested them for 10 days. At the end of the 10 days, Daniel and his three friends looked healthier and better nourished than the young men who had been eating the food assigned by the king. So after that, the attendant fed them only vegetables instead of the food and wine provided for the others. God gave these four young men an unusual aptitude for understanding every aspect of literature and wisdom. And God gave Daniel the special ability to interpret the meanings of visions and dreams." Verse 18. "When the training period ordered by the king was completed, the chief of staff brought all the young men to to King Nebuchadnezzar. The king talked with them, and no one impressed them as much as Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. So they entered the royal service. Whenever the king consulted them in any matter requiring wisdom and balanced judgment, he found them 10 times more capable than any of the magicians and enchanters in his entire kingdom. 10 times better than anyone else. And I'd like to invite Ian and Shari over here and invite Pastor to pray over them as well. They will be our pastors for the day. Karibuni sana, as you talk to us about 10 times better. We want to be 10 times better. Welcome.
Father, your word tells us that you empower your people to speak. And this morning, Lord, we want to commit these two to share with us what is in their hearts, what you've shared with them to share with us. That, Lord, we may be encouraged and also challenged. I thank you for them. I thank you for the time they've taken to prepare. And may they be courageous to tell us everything you've said to them. And Lord, may we also be courageous to follow and obey. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Something new. Okay, I hope you'll hear me. So my name is Ian Orunga. Shari and I will be taking us through today's sermon part. And before we proceed, I think I'll just say something small and something short before Shari steps in, then I'll come back later. First of all, I'd like just to ask, what comes to our minds when we hear the word junction? Because your kids tell you, oh, they're coming for the junction. You never ask them whether they're going to Devki or the other main road, the junction, to come to the Eastern. So what comes to our minds when we hear the word junction? What is it? What is a junction to us? Steve, don't help them now. Anyone? Oh, we don't know what a junction is.
We train ourselves and we need to make a decision which direction to go, left or right.
Thank you. You say you need to make a decision which direction to take, left or right. Any other person? Mr. Vene is giving us a translation. Makutano. Any other person? I'm on Mimaliza. Yes.
A place to learn.
Thank you, Julius. Anyone else? I'm on work with those ones for now.
Where different roads meet.
Pardon?
The meeting of different roads.
Yes, the meeting of different roads. So we call the program the junction. Can't you lift your hand?
No, I'm
okay. Yes, Willie.
It is a place where we have a common point, but we have different routes getting from that common point.
Yeah, so basically different routes meeting at one point. That's the junction. I think that puts it even much better. So I'm sure in all the definitions that we've been given, they all make sense. They all tell us the meaning of the junction. And I'm sure at least one of them we can relate to in one way or another. So for us, we came up with the name The Junction to mean just exactly that, a place where more than two roads. In our thinking, the roads are not the tarmac ones. The roads are now the head, the heart, and the hand. Okay? Yeah, the head, heart, and then our hands. So of course, we take kids through various activities to teach them spiritual things, as we'll of course find out as we continue the sermon. Then we hope by the end of it all, this junction will help them be different people at the end of the 3 months that we'll be having. So at this point, actually, before I invite Shari, I'd like to just send us back to what we read from the passage of Daniel chapter 1. But I think I'll go to verse 18. Verse 18, yes. No, to verse 20. I'll take us back to verse 20. Anyone who can read for us, verse 20? Actually, before you even continue, Steve, could you please help me with that container? Yes. Does anyone know what this is or what these are? Anyone? Things in a container. Okay, I think I'll give the opportunity to one of the people who come to the junction to tell us what they are. Julius, I'll give you another. No, let me give it to Rungari. Julius, you've spoken. Rungari, you can tell us what these are.
One-sided or two-sided? Good and bad or everything?
Tell them everything. Let's not hide anything from them. Okay. Let them not tell us that they didn't know.
Okay. So what Ian has there are merits and demerits. So when you do something good, something great, something really, really nice, he gives you a merit for a job well done. If you do something that makes somebody sad or something that's not right, you get a sad face, which is a demerit because you did something that didn't make us smile. So yes, that's what that is. And they put in a nice container that you can see how much progress you're making.
Yeah, so these are things we give to the kids. These are the merits, okay? Beautiful, the kids enjoy having it. And then, of course, we also have the sad faces, as Rungari has already explained. And we have the smiley faces. Oh, we only had the sad ones. Then we have the smiley faces. Okay? Yeah, I won't repeat what she's already said. So in our case today, I want to give us an opportunity to help the kids get something. Yes, they get the pieces of paper, the merits, and the smiley faces, but then at the end of the month and at the end of the term, that will be on 6th of December, we'll be converting them, we'll be redeeming the smiley faces for some special gift. Sasa? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I know you're used to the redeeming thing, because Safaricom ametuzoesha bonga points and all. So the kids will be redeeming them for some gifts. And today, I want to give us an opportunity to help the kids get as much as they can. Okay? So I want us to add value to their containers. So anytime you'll be responding to anything, whether it will be a question from Shari or from me, or maybe reading for us a Bible verse, and I think that has to go to someone. Someone read for us the verse. Right?
Not yet.
Oh, not yet. Yeah. Oh, yeah, she's going to read. Yeah, so as she'll be reading, I'll give her one. Since we are here, some of us are parents to kids who come to the junction. And some do not have kids who come to the junction. For those who don't have kids who come to the junction program, I'll give you the opportunity to pick one and give to the kid you think, according to you, maybe deserves it or you think you can take for them. So. Yeah, so all of us will have someone to give at the end of the day. So you'll take it, then after they're done with their Sunday school, you'll hand it to them. They know where to place them. Or they look for me or Rungari, and then we'll show them where to place them in their containers. And then if the one you want to give to is not in, you'll just bring to one of us, and then we'll place in their container. So we are together, Apo. Mm-hmm. Okay, now we can go back to the passage.
In every matter of wisdom and understanding, about which the king questioned them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters in his whole kingdom.
Thank you. That is NIV. No, not NIV. That's NIV. Mm-hmm. Oh, thank you. It says it exactly as I had hoped it will. Yeah, so we... Steve, what do you respond when I say the junction? What do you say?
10 times better.
10 times better. So we say the junction is 10 times better. That's sort of our slogan for the junction program. And it's 10 times better in line with the passage that we just read. So a lot of it will be explained as we continue the sermon. So I'll give this opportunity to Shari to continue. I'll just help her in handing this. And of course, Pastor Phyllis has done her work. So I'll give her one. And then as Shari takes over.
Morning. We've been talking about junction, and but I wonder how many people really know what is behind it or where it came from. Let me take my phone off here. Where it came from, where did the idea come from, etc. You guys remember way back during the lockdown and everything, and we were talking about the different sectors in the community. There was the health and education, that we did family, livelihoods, etc., right? And we've been engaging in these for quite a few months now. And health and education actually started off like together, but they've kind of in a way separated and kind of diverged. And so when the idea of starting some kind of a program for the children first surfaced, I began to get, you know, excited because it was something different. Different than school, different than Sunday school, you know, different than the typical kind of stuff that you find here in Kenya, that program for children. And so then Pastor came up with this idea, we need to, and he starts talking about, you know, the basic points about junction. We need to have this kind of program. And I'm thinking, yeah, yeah, we do. And then he says, we need somebody to put some structure to it. And, yeah, yeah, we do. He says, will you do it, please? No, no, I won't. Because I had no idea where to start. And I'm like, Lord, where do I start? I don't know where to begin. I don't know. I've never, you know. And so I prayed about it. And then I kept asking him. He's saying, yeah, you can do it. And I'm like, I don't know where to start. But then I went home and I just prayed about it, and it was like literally, it just like boom, 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 just started coming. So I went and I sat down at my computer and just started typing it all out, and just it just came, the whole thing just came, literally just came like that. And I was just really amazed. And then I turned it over and said, Ian, take it. Take the baby. What we have learned, because it's been a learning process, I think. I think it has been for you too, quite a bit, yeah. And so we have learned a few things. And basically, I could say we've learned two things, two really basic major things as we have engaged in this whole thing of education and working with children and having some kind of program that can help them be 10 times better, you know, than all the others. Number one, and it's a three-portion one, number one. Learning should be broad-based, or you could say holistic. Should be fun, or you could say exciting. And it should be lifelong. Okay, learning should be broad-based, it should be fun, it should be lifelong. And we'll go into that in a little bit more detail. Number two, all of learning should be permeated or infused with God's presence, His power, and His principles. So all of learning should be centered and infused, centered around and infused with God. So let's just take these points briefly, one by one, and then Ian will get back up and tell about the practical parts of it. This is the skeleton. You know, this is the structure part, you know. One, learning should be broad-based. Sometimes you use the word holistic. I was doing some notes for one of the training seminars, and I had sent the notes to the pastor, and I had put holistic with a W, W-H-O-L. And that was intentional, by the way, but I didn't want to argue. He says, no, it's H-O-L, because the proper spelling is H-O-L-I-S-T-I-C, holistic. But I said, I'm going to put the W in there because we are whole. We're looking at the whole person. And so learning should be like that. In verse 17 of that same pastor, that passage that we read, it said, to these four young men, God gave knowledge and understanding in one kind of literature?
All
kinds of literature and learning. All kinds. And Daniel could understand visions and dreams of all kinds. Okay, I think God designed us to have a broad knowledge, a broad understanding of His world, His creation, of ourselves, of each other, of skills, He would like us to have a broad understanding. Even now, in research, they are finding that there's more than one kind of intelligence. You know, this whole thing about IQ, okay? How many of you have ever had an IQ test? And this is your chance for a merit, by the way. How many of you have ever had an IQ test? Okay, we have a couple here that had IQ tests. Okay, I won't ask, you know, what your scores were. And yet now it's beginning to come out of favor in the world of education. Why? Because they're discovering that there's more to life than the 3 hours, reading, writing, and arithmetic. There's more than head knowledge. Life is about much more than head knowledge. And there's naturalistic intelligence. That's understanding the world around us, growing things. People who are planting gardens like Lucy and Patience and stuff like that, they understand about how things grow and how to nurture things and let it grow. Animals. There's musical intelligence. People like Stella, who understand how music works and how it ministers to people, how it grabs, you know, it ministers to the soul and touches the soul of a human being. Some of that is like a natural kind of knowledge. There's logistical and mathematical, something I am not really good at, okay? I have a broad-based education, but I'm afraid my understanding of mathematics is kind of like down there. But there are others who are geniuses at it. And boy, if you happen to be the treasurer of LCC, you're grateful for the people who understand how knowledge numbers work. There's interpersonal, okay? Helen and I, we studied psychology together. And in psychology, you learn about how people interact with each other. How do you work with people? How do you get to understand people? There's all kinds of different kinds of learning and understanding and intelligence. There's linguistics. I think, Peter, you're probably strong in the area of linguistics. We know Mbora is. And these are the people who could learn languages very easily. It seems to come naturally to them. And they know how to craft words. Wendy, I think, is a writer. She loves to write. And so they know how to craft words and write things so that people can enjoy and learn many different kinds of intelligence. I'd like to play a video that Pastor actually had posted on the WhatsApp group, I think you did. And it really describes quite well about this whole idea of learning being broad-based. So we'll just look at that a little bit. This is going to be like a little bits and pieces kind of message today. Enjoy this one, this clip.
Just experience of the system is often profoundly alienating. This isn't the fault of their teachers, but of the system itself, which assesses us for a particular kind of intelligence. We pass or fail on ridiculously narrow criteria. I was lucky at school because I had the kind of intelligence they were looking for: linear, analytical, hyperlexic. It was only after leaving school that I realized, in other respects, I was a complete dummy. I stumble over cognitive tasks that other people can perform in their sleep. I have a close friend who I see as a genius. He can listen to an engine, even on the phone, and tell you the problem is a particular bearing. He has a remarkable spatial navigational intelligence, and even professional mechanics wonder how on earth he can do it. But he was deemed a total failure at school. He was confronted with tests that didn't fit the way his mind worked. I expect you've come across plenty of people like this. People you know are bright, but they're bright in the wrong way. They're bright in the way that isn't being assessed. The truth is that there are lots of different intelligences. And we shouldn't be surprised. During the evolutionary phase of our history, a group of people will be more likely to survive if its different members saw the world in different ways. Some people could make excellent tools. Some people could hunt very well. Some people were good at looking out for danger. Some people were good at strategizing how to get through a long winter. Some people could tell the stories that would inform the next generation. We needed a load of different intelligences in order to survive. Nowadays, we are treated as if only one kind of intelligence is valid. Anyone with a different intelligence is deemed stupid. The way we are schooled compounds this alienation. How did we get to the point that we believe the best way of schooling children is to sit them behind a desk and insist they keep still? Children keeping still? That's difficult for anyone, but especially for kids with a roaming, navigational mind. I've done some volunteering with an adventure learning charity, and the first time I took a group of these children out, we were rock pooling on the shore. Most of the kids had never seen the sea before, never visited the countryside before. And there was one kid who just stood out. He was brilliant. He was there at my shoulder all the time. Whenever I said, "What's this?" or "Why is it this color?" he would hazard a guess. And they were always interesting answers. He was finding things, catching things, picking things up. And after a couple of hours, I said to his teacher, "That kid is a genius." She said, "Him? He's bottom of the class." If a kid like that is failing, it is not the kid's fault. The fault is with the system. As I say, I don't blame the teachers because they have to teach to the system. Plenty of teachers desperately want to do creative things with their children, to discover their different intelligences, but they are forbidden to do so. If an intelligent child fails a test designed to assess a different kind of intelligence, they become alienated, not just from school, but from the system as a whole. The danger is that they then become alienated from public life, alienated from society, eventually alienated from themselves.
How many of us here were really good exam takers? There are some. But how many of you could relate when you did badly on an exam and you're thinking, but I'm not stupid? Or how many felt like I'm stupid because in the system, the education system, you didn't quite fit in? I had a daughter like that. And it was really tough, really, really tough, because she didn't learn in the way that the system said that she had to learn. And it was very, very tough. In the end, I ended up homeschooling her for a number of years, partially because of that. And she ended up going to university, doing very well, and she's doing well today. So it makes a difference. It makes a difference to know that all learning should be broad-based. And there are many different kinds of intelligences. And what we wanted to do is to find out, what are these kids? What is the intelligence that they excel in? And how can we help them with the areas that they struggle in and help them to excel in the areas in which they are gifted? We'll let Ian talk more about that. If life were only about head knowledge, if it were only according to what we learn in school, who would fix our cars? Who would cook those tasty meals? You guys, your wives that fix those nice meals at home, I bet you appreciate it, you know? How would we enjoy? There would be no music, no arts to enjoy. I love music. I'm not super talented like this young lady sitting in front of me, but I really enjoy it. I really, really enjoy it. Okay? Number two, learning should be, what was the second one? Learning should be broad-based, but it should also be?
Fun.
Fun. Okay, for how many of us is this new? A new concept that learning should be fun. Okay, here we go. Okay, there you go, Wilson. He gets one of them. Learning should be fun. Now, how many of us have ever, when we were growing up, equated learning with fun? Not me. My hands are down. No way. No way! I did not like school. I didn't like it at all, at all. And yet, I'm convinced that human beings were designed to enjoy learning, to find it stimulating, to find it an enjoyable thing. And God has created us so that when we embark on an activity that is pleasurable, we want to do it what? Again? And again? And again? Okay? If we can make learning fun for kids, if we can make it exciting for our kids, will they just quit as soon as they're finished with a particular lesson? How they will want to do it again. And they will ask questions. And can we do something else? And can we do, you know, and they will, and I've seen children do that when they are encouraged to enjoy and to find, to enjoy learning and to find it exciting. God created the things of this world for our enjoyment and for us to find fulfillment in it, including work and including learning. What is learning? It's the work for the child, right? Is that so? That's the child's occupation, to be learning, to be growing, to be developing. In Ecclesiastes, now I've got several verses, so I would just suggest you just write down the references and look them up when you get home, okay? Because so we don't, in the interest of time. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, 11 through 13, it says, He has made everything beautiful in its time. He's also set eternity in the human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there's nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live. That each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. It is what? A gift of God. It's a gift. Work, learning, all these things are a gift. Why do we make it a drudgery? Why do we make it something that children and even adults, when later we're talking about work, dread? It should be enjoyable. So learning should be what?
Broad-based.
Pastor gets one. Learning should be broad-based, and it should be
fun.
And what's the third one? Anybody remember that one?
Lifelong.
Oh, there goes. Phyllis gets one. Learning should be lifelong. You guys know how old I am? Okay, you can do it. Come on, I can take it. How old am I? Oh, okay, she gets a demerit. How old am I? Come on, I'm brave. I can take it. No, she's being kind, she's 60 plus. Someone says 65. You get a demerit too. Actually, I'm 64. Am I finished learning?
No.
You bet I'm not. No way. I'm not. It should be a lifelong thing. When any living organism is not growing or not changing, what is it?
Dying.
I heard it right there. It is dying or dead. Okay? And then any parts of our bodies that we don't exercise, what happens to it? Oh, it reduces. Yeah, it withers away, doesn't it? Has anybody broken an arm or a leg? Anybody in here? Yeah, okay, there you go, Wilson. What did you break? An arm, okay? How long did you have that arm in a cast?
Like, 6 weeks.
Yeah, it's usually 8 weeks. If it's an arm or a leg, it's usually, because something that has to bear weight, or it's usually 8 weeks. Did you have to do anything after you got your cast taken off? Yeah, what did you have to do?
To be more careful.
Oh, but besides being more careful, you probably had to exercise it. Some people have to go through physical therapy. Because what happens in those 8 weeks of being immobilized, what happens to the muscles in that arm? Yes, it begins to atrophy. That's a fancy word for you. Atrophy. I get one. Because I use the fancy word. It withers away and it becomes weak. I was joking, actually. But And so now it's not, it can't bear weight as much, it's not as strong, it's not as effective. And so you have to exercise it, you have to use it, you have to have physical therapy to make it strong again, like your other arm or leg or whatever it is that you have broken. What about our brains? What happens to our brains if we don't use our brains? Yeah, same thing. It can wither away, it becomes weak, it becomes not so useful. Research has shown that people who intentionally do things like work puzzles, read a lot, learn a new skill like playing an instrument or learning a new language, first of all, they found that they are capable of doing it right up to the day you die. So this saying about you can't teach an old dog new tricks, don't believe it. Don't believe it at all. Don't use age as an excuse. Talk to myself here. Don't use age as an excuse for not learning something new. Okay? Because research shows that people who continue to exercise their brains and use them well into old age, they can actually even possibly avoid or at least delay the onset of dementia. That's what research is showing. Exercise your brain. Use it. And don't say when you get out of school, I'm finished learning. It shouldn't be. So what are the three things? Learning should be broad-based, fun, and lifelong. What about the second one, the second point that we said that we had learned as we've been working on this? All learning should be permeated with God's presence, His power, and His principles, or His values. This is another thing that we had said about Junction, that we wanted everything to be about God and about His presence, His power, His character, okay? And we wanted that to be a part of life. God is the creator of all things, first of all, right? So He's the source of all learning, right? He's the source of all learning, the source of all wisdom, the source of all things. Human beings were not designed to live independently of God. Do you agree with that? Human beings, we were not designed to live independently of God. We were designed to need Him, and we were designed to reflect His glory. In Psalm 16:11, it says, "You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore." In John 15:5-9, it's much more direct. Jesus is talking to His disciples. He says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit." Then He says something very significant. "Apart from me, you can do
nothing."
What's included in nothing?
Everything.
That's right. Everything is included in nothing. In other words, there is nothing you can do apart from Him. Even waking up in the morning, even drawing your next breath. If you were to decide, this is your last day, that's it. That's it. Could you negotiate and say, well, you could try negotiating, but ultimately, in the end, He's the one who decides. This is it. This is it. Apart from me, you can do
nothing.
Nothing. When human beings try to live independently from God, that's where we get things like wars, pollution, greed, exploitation, poverty, boredom, and all other manner of evil. So all learning, we say, should be permeated with God's presence, power, and principles. We want the children to see that everything in life is from God and should be for God and should reflect His glory. In Colossians 3:17, it says, "Whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him." Later on in verse 23, it says, "Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters." And then finally in 1 Corinthians 10:31, "Whether you eat or drink, whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God." This is what we want to see in Junction. We want to see the children making learning a lifelong thing. We want to see them enjoying it and having a good time learning. And we want to see them having a broad-based understanding of the world around them and of themselves and of skills to do. And then we want to be sure that they know that all of life really comes from and centers around God. So now Ian's going to talk about, well, how? How does Junction do that? He's going to talk about how we plan to proceed. I gave you the skeleton, now he's going to put the flesh on it.
Good morning again.
Good morning.
Before you continue, we'll just play a short testimony from one of the kids who attend the Junction program, so that you can see what's the feedback from them directly. Sinisa.
Hi. How are you?
I'm thank
you. What's your name?
My name is Sharon Tebler.
And what program are you attending right now?
I'm attending the Junction.
Which group are you in?
I'm in group 2.
And what age is in group 2?
10 to 13.
Okay. What do you love about the Junction?
I love the sports. We learn, we are being taught about how to play hockey and baseball and chess. And also the cooking. Well, we are taught how to cook mandazis and samosas.
Okay, what have you learned so far?
I've learned about honesty. I've learned also about obedience and also helping people.
Okay, thanks for your time.
Yeah, so that was it. Then I'll just show us a few photos of some of the things that happen. Because that's when the kids are washing utensils after they've eaten. Then of course they do the cooking. The teachers, we just guide them. We don't do a lot of stuff. We just guide them through to give them the opportunity that maybe some of the parents might have denied them. But some of them actually tell us that parents don't give them the opportunity to cook. But then they enjoy. So that's actually a challenge to all of us. If you have kids, please make sure that they help you in one way or another in the kitchen. There's always something they can do. These kids, some of them, I can see someone like Mitch there. Mitch is around. It's between six and nine. He's in bracket. And of course, that's the youngest that we have, that group. Then, of course, you also have the older ones. So everyone has a role they can play in the kitchen. Of course, eating is for everyone. Yeah. So those are some of the things that we've been doing at the Junction. Yeah. But before I continue, Sharon, we had to record because she doesn't attend service here at LCC, but you also have, let me call him, one of our own. So I'll invite Steve to join me. Steve, Karibu.
Sure. Karibu. This is for you, Steve.
What was the camera? Okay. So Steve, you can tell us what do you like about the Junction program?
I like it because it shows us how to help our parents and to help our parents in the doing of work, and it shows us how to have good manners and not just having bad manners, because when the first time I came here I didn't know some games like hockey and baseball. Like now I know, and I'm great to God that I know.
Wow, that's great. And what would you like to say to those kids maybe who haven't attended the program?
To attend, because it's a nice program, mm-hmm. and it's a good program in the knowledge, and to have knowledge.
Okay, thank you. Anything else you want to add?
No.
So, thank you. Thank you, Steve. Yeah. Because he'll be confident with time. Isn't you, Steve? Yeah, so that's basically what happens with the Junction program. We try and make sure that they're involved throughout. I would like to request someone to read for us the book of Luke, chapter 2, verse 52. Luke chapter 2, verse 52.
Jesus grew both in body and in wisdom, gaining favor with God and people.
You can repeat again? You can say it again.
Jesus grew both in body and in wisdom, gaining favor with God and people.
Yeah, any other version? Someone with any different version?
As Jesus grew, so did his wisdom and maturity. The favor of men increased upon his life, for he was loved greatly by God.
Wow, wonderful. Amen. So from what we've heard, or from what we are reading, for those of us who have our Bibles, in what areas do you think Jesus was growing? Of course, we've been told, but now thinking of it fully. Now, of course, if they tell us he's growing in hand, how is he growing? Is it intellectual, social, spiritual, whatever, what is it? So what do you pick from that passage? In what ways was Jesus growing? We can break them down. Holistically, you're covering everything. Don't put that blanket there. Wisdom, that means he was growing in which way? Intellectually, right? Yeah, so he's growing intellectually. Any other?
Physically,
because they tell us he's growing tall, right? Then anything else?
Socially.
Yeah.
And spiritually.
Yeah, so actually that's the verse that guides everything that you do in the junction. You want the kids to grow physically, of course, through the sports activities and all. Then you also want them to grow intellectually through the health section. Then, of course, spiritually and social, that runs across the board in everything they do, including preparation of the snacks. Mm-hmm. Sawa sawa? Yeah, so just to give us a brief, in the health section, we focus mainly on the intellect, provide the kids with various learning material, and then, of course, you have teachers to help them. So we try to make things a bit different from what they normally do at school. I know most of us, when we went through the 844 system, some of us were solely dependent on the teachers. Whatever the teacher gave is what you knew as the gospel. So even if you went home and said something and someone asked you, where did you pick that from? Our teacher taught us, but it's not something that maybe you've read on your own or something. So we try to incorporate some things that we've borrowed from the SEE system, where they teach through paces. That basically means that every kid learns at their own pace. So you don't feel like you're competing with the person next to you. If you're a slow learner, we'll move you, we'll make sure that you're learning at your pace. We don't try and fasten things up for you. So the kids are given everything they need, and then they try and go ahead and maybe read or write or whatever that's supposed to be written. And in case they get stuck, we have a very good group of volunteers who are always ready to help them in those areas. So we try to make them rely more on themselves in terms of getting knowledge, so that they don't end up just sitting there and waiting for the teacher throughout. Mm-hmm. And I think that was a good thing, especially during these COVID times. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they were not going to school. So if your kid had already learned such things, they wouldn't have been having any problem. You wouldn't have been forced to maybe enroll them for some tuition or something. Mm-hmm. They'll most likely have been learning on their own, right? Yeah, then in the heart section, we deal with the matters of the heart. As the Bible tells us in the book of Luke, chapter 6, verse 45, a good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart. And an evil man, what does he bring? Evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. So we try and make sure that the kids have something good filling their heart. In the heart section, so that out of it, the good things may be flowing in the rest of their lives. So we use engaging activities to teach them that, to make sure that it's interesting, as Shadi has already shared with us, how important it is to make things exciting for the kids, so that they end up coming for the next session. We don't want them to look forward to the next session, but you want them to enjoy the session such that they don't want the session to end. Yes. Or rather, if they're looking forward to the next session, it's because they want to do this the best way they can, so they can even get to the next session and do it even in a much better way. And we say they want to do the next thing 10 times better every other time that they do it. So some of the things that we look at in that heart section is etiquette, respect, honor, and commitment within this first term that we've been having, and it's still on. And of course, we are hoping that in the near future, in the next term, in the terms to come, that we'll be dealing with other issues that kids might be passionate about, which may involve things like environment, social justice, so that even as they grow, we make sure that we give them things that will help them grow in their passions. Because we all know that passion drives our lives, right? No one wants to wake up every morning feeling like they want to go to work just because the boss is there. Maybe when the boss is not there, they don't have to go to work. You want to go to work because you enjoy what you're doing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that when you even look at your watch and maybe it's time to go home, well, you're happy you're going home, but at the same time you're sad because you're living what you like, right? Yeah, so when we get the right connections and resources at the right time, it supports our passion and then we end up flourishing in it. That's something that maybe some of us lacked when we were growing up. Maybe you didn't get some things that were supposed to help you grow much better in the areas of your passion. So maybe you're struggling when you're older to catch up with things, and well, you might manage, but you won't be as good as you would have been if you got those things early enough in your life. So we try and make sure that these kids get everything they need in the program, so that as they continue growing, we want Lukenya area to have people who've really grown, people who really influence the society, and of course Kenya at large. Yeah, in the hand section, we of course kick it off with some art and crafts, drawing, coloring. Of course, we have people who are very good in those areas. They help us a lot to engage the kids in those activities. We link it a lot more with the heart section. So if they learn something in the heart section, we make sure that the hand is a follow-up. So whatever they are making is something that still passes the same message that they received in the heart section. So we hope that some time later, in the next terms, we'll also be teaching them some things like playing musical instruments, because they're things that, of course, involve the hands, computer skills, and many other things. So, of course, if you also have an idea, you can drop it in. But, of course, you don't just need ideas. We also need people who can put those ideas to work, right? Yeah, because some things we might say that we want to teach them some musical instruments, but if we have no one among us, the volunteers, who can play a musical instrument, then clearly no one can teach that, right? Yeah, so if you have a skill you think you need to pass it on to the next generation, then the next generation is here at the junction. You need to be thinking about it. I'll take us back a bit to some small activity. I'm not a preacher. most of the people I interact with are young people maybe in campus and of course kids. Yeah, but I'm hoping we'll enjoy what we're going to do next. So Steve, I don't know if you can go back to the slides. Slides, Apochini, PowerPoint. Yes. Yes, click there. Okay, so Apo, yeah. Thank you. You can go to the next. Yeah. So what can we see on the screen?
Some.
You can see something. Some can see an eye. What can you see? What? A black number one. Yeah, so since in the junction we are teachers, we teach. And today I thought that also I may use this opportunity to teach us something. And I'm going to teach us Chinese numbers. Oh, they are my Chinese numbers. Okay. They are my Chinese numbers. So you shouldn't be scared that maybe it's something you won't be able to understand. It's so easy, by the way. Very easy. All you need to do is just not just focus on the screen alone. Of course, the screen has something very important you need to see, right? But then focus on everything else that's happening. Okay. I know all of us are adults, so we can easily understand. When I tell you this is number one, you can easily tell it's number one. If I tell you it's number two, you can easily tell it's number two. When I ask you for number three, then clearly you should be able to tell me what number three is, right? I won't give you the hard effort of starting to draw and all that, so I've done the drawing for you on that. So you'll only be telling me what number it is. So like, for example, this one, this number is actually not one. Yes, it's actually not one. This number is two. Yes, this number is two. Yeah, this number is two. Yes, in Chinese, this number is two. Yes, let's put the English aside for now. So this number is two, right? Steve, take us to the next slide. And that number, now that number is one.
In Chinese, it's one.
Yes, that number is one. Who else believes it's one?
In that language, the teacher says
the teacher says it's one, so it's one.
Yeah, right.
Okay, now we're going to the tough part where you'll be helping me figure out what number it is. Steve, move to the next. What number is that?
Three.
That number is three?
Four.
Okay, I think we won't be doing the choruses. We'll be lifting our hands up. What number is that? No. Steve, what number is that?
Five.
That number is four. No, it's not four. What number is that?
Five.
Five? I really know. What number is that? Rungari, no, it's not two. What number is that?
Three.
You're saying three? That's Julius. Give Julius a smiley face. Yes, I said that number is three. That number is three. Okay? Don't think so hard. I said it's not just about whatever you're seeing on the screen. It's a lot more, right? So that number is three. That number is three. Okay. Steve, I'm giving you too much work. Okay, let's see the next one. And what about that number? What number is that?
Five.
Four. No, it's not five. Any other person?
Four.
What number is that?
Four.
Yes, that number is four. I agree. That number is four. You can give her. Give her. Give her one. That number is four. That number is four. Okay. Rugari, I think you might move closer to help me so that Steve doesn't end up moving around too much. You move to, this is the next one. This one number that is. No, go back. Yes, that number. That number, what number is that? What number is that? Anyone? Yes, Lucy. That's number five. Give Lucy a smiley. That's number five. That's number five. I give you one more.
Yes.
Yeah.
I give you one more. Okay. Let's see. What number is that?
Six.
No, that number is not six. It can't be six. What number is that?
Seven.
No, it's not.
Eight. Two.
No, it's not two. Guys, I said it's more than the screen. What number is that? Okay, Steve, give us the next one. I think that one is a bit hard for them. The next one?
Eight.
This one. What number is that?
Six.
Yes, that's number six. Give Percy one. That's number six. Do you guys want me to tell you your party in Kenya?
No,
I'm thinking you have to bring your next.
Okay, move to the next one. Actually, one thing I should remind us is that in my Chinese numbers, whatever you see there might look different, but it might still be the same number. There are different ways of writing a given number. You can write one in so many other ways. Okay? Yeah. It's possible to do that. So, what number is that?
Seven.
It's not four, people.
Seven.
I said we should try and see. What number is this?
One.
Seven.
What number is this?
One.
Percy knows. It's one.
No.
Yes, it's one. Guys, I told you guys this number is one. But I'm saying right now this number is one. You guys can't see it.
No.
It's one. Okay, give me the next one. That's the next one. What number is this?
Two.
Three.
Guys.
Three.
Thank you, Wilson. You can give Wilson one. That number is three. I think I'll leave it there.
Yeah.
Also, for Paul Macho for class, I think you'll give the others tuition. You give the others tuition. Yeah, so, basically, what has been happening there, by the way, it's actually not on the screen.
Yeah, it's on your hands.
Now you give Unapatia Mwakenya too soon. Yeah, it wasn't on the screen. It's away from the screen.
Yeah.
So all we needed to do is focus on the details. Okay? Lucy, clearly it looks like you guessed the one you got. Yeah, but then maybe after the service, some of us had already figured out we'll try and help the rest, didn't you? Yeah, for the interest of time. So in the junction program, we basically focus on the details. Okay? We focus on the details. Not just what you're given, but a lot more. So we give the kids materials to do whatever they're doing, but we also try and find out how they're doing in their lives at home, at school, and try to help them in one way or the other. And also amongst us as volunteers, we also try and help each other in areas that we're not good at. Of course, for us as volunteers, none of us is good in everything. For some of us, for example, for me, I coach hockey, yes, but I've never coached kids hockey. So for me, it was also a challenge to start doing that. We also have people who are teaching kids chess. They've never taught kids chess before. So it's actually a first time opportunity. So for most of us, we are trying out new things. And that's a challenge to all of us, that we should actually be trying out new things at times, right? Yeah, so all of us are learning, even as we continue with the process. Just getting us back to that, I want you to just find out, how do you guys feel about the numbers? How do you guys feel about the numbers? Anyone, you can raise your hand. Are they hard? Are they easy? How was it? Willie?
If you are taught the first two, mm-hmm. then you can move on.
Mm-hmm. Then you can move on. Mm-hmm. But you are taught the first around three before you move on. Okay, help us see.
There was nothing on the screen that you needed to focus on.
Thank you. Any other? Okay, let's look at it in terms of now our lives. Our lives. What happens in our lives, as in comparing that with how we live our lives normally, whether it will have been how we used to be in school or how we are being right now, maybe at work, or maybe at home, how can it relate? How can it relate?
Life is more than what you're seeing.
Thank you. Life is more than what you're seeing. Mm. So you shouldn't just look at what you're seeing only, you should try and think more. And look more to the little details. Anything else? Guys, you have the answers. Yes, Percy, Madam Ellen.
You may not have all the information. You may need to figure out some details for yourself.
For yourself. Mm-hmm. Thank you. And that's actually the reason why we also give things to the kids. We want them to figure out some things. Then when they feel like they're stuck, Kabisa, like now some of us felt stuck, that's when we come in and help them. And that's why I've said we'll help you after the service. So we won't leave you like that. Yeah, any other thing? Yes, Willie?
In life, sometimes you not be taught everything. You have to challenge yourself to do something else.
Thank you. That's basically what you do at the junction, challenging ourselves. You know, some of the kids actually, especially when you're doing the section for preparation of the snacks, some of them, they are things that they look at them like, these are things that are supposed to be done with our parents, not us. Mm-hmm. Like I think there's one, Stella was just sharing with me yesterday, that there's one kid who was saying that he's never prepared any meal at home. He's never played a part. Even that one for Mpatie Kijiko, as in, he's never been part of it. Of course, he's a boy, so it also tells us something about them. Maybe the guys are the ones who used to doing things in the kitchen and all. Yeah, in that case, the boy didn't have that opportunity, but then you're giving him the opportunity at the junction. And he really enjoys doing that. He really enjoys doing that. I thought that maybe he would say, I don't do this thing at home, so I don't want to do it, but then he's interested. Mm-hmm. He also wants to try this something new and see how best, maybe he'll challenge the mom sometime. You know, we shouldn't get used to just leaving our kids with food in the fridge. Kuambia tu utachemsha ukisikia njaa. Yeah, we should also trust them, of course, depending on their age. Yeah. Yeah, anything else that we might have left out? Yes.
We are all gifted differently.
Thank you. We are all gifted differently. Runs through. Maybe you can expound a bit on it relating to the game. Yeah.
Maybe I may be gifted in artwork, and maybe the other one is gifted in maybe entrepreneurship, like carpentry.
Yes.
You know.
Thank you. And it actually relates well with even the video that we played before, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it relates well with the video that we played before, and that's what we still do with the kids. We know that all of them are good in different things. That's why we give them an opportunity to explore things. We give them, for example, in sports, they all played each sport that we have in the junction program. But then afterwards, we told them, now you guys, you can choose. When they come every morning, you ask them, today, what do you want to play? They'll tell us, I want to go to baseball. You go to baseball. You want to go to hockey? You go to hockey. You want chess? You can go to chess. So we no longer force them. We want them to continue with whatever they enjoy doing, whatever they like so much to do, so that they keep growing in that area. Anything else as you wind up?
Don't let what you can't solve hold you from trying out new stuff.
Like when I didn't manage to get the number one that Percy managed, mm-hmm. but then I was trying to figure out what could be the next one, like the next one. So along the way, then I figured out, oh, so that one else maybe could have been number one, then the solutions will come as you go.
As you go on.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for that. Light, I think that will be the last.
Okay. I was saying, you know, we are not perfect sometimes in life. You may be wrong.
Thank you. I think that's self-explanatory, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't need to expound so much on that. I would like someone to read for us James chapter 3, verse 5. James chapter 3, verse 5. Anyone who's ready?
In the same way, the tongue is a small thing that makes grand speeches, but a tiny spark can set a great forest on fire.
Thank you. You can read it again, please.
James chapter 3, verse 5. In the same way, the tongue is a small thing that makes grand speeches, but a tiny spark can set a great forest on fire.
Thank you. In simple terms, the little things that we do in life really have a huge impact. So it doesn't matter how little or how big something looks like, it always has a big impact in our lives. So these little things are what matters. They create gaps in our lives. You might assume that a kid already knows something, but then you're creating a gap, and it will be so hard for you to try and fill that gap sometime later in life. It will be so hard for you to wait for that kid to grow up and maybe go to college, for you to start teaching them how to cook, because you know that they're going to live alone in campus. But probably if it's something that you started doing when they were still kids, you might have created that interest in them. But now that they're already in campus and you want to start teaching them, they're no longer interested in it. So they might come there, you keep talking, and they get nothing at the end of the day. They end up going to campus and they just be eating in the hotels. Because anyway, they were told from the time they were kids they shouldn't be cooking, right? Yeah. Then of course fun runs across everything we do in our sessions. Whether it's in the head section, in the heart, or in the hand section, sports or snacks, you make sure that the kids have fun while they're doing everything that they do. And scripture is at the core of every activity. We relate everything with scriptures. Even when they are being taught anything in the heart section or in the head section, we make sure that it's all based on scriptures. We try as much as possible to use the example of Christ, because of course that's the perfect example. We say that you're Christians, then clearly we need to be like Christ, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So just to give an example, for this month, we, as I wind up, for this month we've been having commitment as the theme for the month. And the theme verse is what we've been seeing here every other week. Yeah, I know some people have been wondering, you come here, you see theme verse, you don't see Percy referring to the theme verse. Yeah, it's because this is not for us on Sunday, but it's for the kids on Saturday. So the theme verse for the month is, commit everything you do to the Lord, trust Him, and He will help you. That's the theme verse for this month, and every month has one. So the kids have been working on, in the head section, they've been working on correcting areas that they identified after doing what you call diagnostic tests. They are basically just tests to find out which areas you're strong in, what you need to be working on, and all that. Then, of course, the next month now we need to be correcting. We need to continue with the corrections where necessary, and also advance to those who will be ready to move on, because they said that they are learning according to their pace, the pace they are moving with. And of course, the first part of the class has to begin with a discussion. In this case, for this month, it started with the discussion on Jesus' commitment to ministry. As I said, it's the perfect example of who the kids should grow up to be. Then in the heart section, they were taught on how to make commitments in their lives based on the scriptural examples, of course. Then in the hand, I said it relates to what they do in the heart section. So they make commitment pledges. Anyone who knows what that is? A commitment pledge. Okay, probably you get to know more about it when... if you attend the graduation, which will be on 6th of December, yeah, you'll get an opportunity to see what that commitment pledge looks like. Steve, you know what it is, right? Because I'm going to ask you to tell us something. So they basically wrote down things that they commit to do. Things that they commit to do, of course, now in the when they're out of here, whether it's at home or at school, things that they commit to do. And then we also follow up. It's basically a follow-up of what they did in the heart section. So we keep asking them how they are faring on with whatever they committed to do. So I think as I finish, I'd just like to ask Steve, what did you commit to do? What did you write in your commitment plan that you're going to do? Maybe you can share with us. I don't know too.
To be an honest boy and ensure respect to the elders.
And respect to the elders. Yeah, let's clap for him. That's his commitment. There's one interesting one we read. Of course, we read the commitment pledge. His commitment pledge was saying that I can't remember exactly what was it. He shouldn't be beating the brother or something. He shouldn't be beating the brother. That's one of the things that he's committing to do. So clearly that also tells us something of what he used to do before. And clearly, I thought that was a joke when Stella told me. So I asked that person today morning, what did you commit to do? And he told me that exactly. So clearly it's at the back of his head. It's a good thing. It also motivates us as teachers that whatever we are teaching them, they keep in their head and they're willing to continue doing it for the rest of their lives. Sawa?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you so much for being a good audience, being a good class in my Chinese class session. And I'm hoping we've all learned something in everything that we've had today. And I'm hoping all of us will also play a part in our kids' lives. So tupe kwa walimu. Okay? So let the teachers be adding the top layer in the kids' lives, but then let's make sure that you also give them that good foundation in terms of academics. Simisawa, let us believe and pray. Father God, we come before this moment. Thank you for having given us life this morning, for having enabled each one of us to show up for this service. And we thank you for the word that you've also enabled us to share. We know that you've given so many examples in the things that you do with the kids, but these things also happen in our normal lives as adults. And we pray that, Father God, you may enable us to be good examples to the kids, and you may enable each one of us to also take that challenge and mentor some of the kids in our community and even in our homes, oh God, that they may be kids who follow the example of Christ. They may always do the right thing, and they may always be willing to learn. As you say, they may learn in the areas that they are blessed in. In various sections of intellect, in the various levels of intelligence, oh God, whether it will be the naturalist, musical, logical, bodily, linguistics, intrapersonal, spatial, Father God, we pray that you may guide them, that they may keep growing in those areas, and that you may direct them to people who will also motivate them, to people who will guide them to become the best in everything that they do. We thank you and we honor you. It is in Jesus' name that I pray, believing and trusting. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much.
Clap like you will get a merit for clapping. That's better. Wow. The education team. 10 times better. Now we are 10 times better. We know some Chinese, right? Then go brag, you know some Chinese. Thank you so much, Shari and Ian. We feel part of the junction, don't we? Aren't you looking forward to enroll in the next class, like me? I think there's lots of fun there. Thank you for what you're doing with the children and making a difference in this community. I'm looking forward to see what those children will become, grow to become, because we made time, we spent time with them to build them as all-round children. May the Lord bless you. We've come to the end of our service. Thank you for hanging on and staying on. And we'd like to close with a song. We shall play a song and feel free to stand as it plays, sing along, or stay seated in the house of the Lord. And there is freedom in this house. So